Welcome to another episode of Citizen Pinoy. This is going to be a very interesting and informative episode for you. So make sure to get your papel and lapis out, because we have with us today the Consul General of the Philippine Consulate in LA, Edgar Badajos, and we are going to be talking about a number of subjects that will interest you, such as obtaining a Philippine passport if you entered under an assumed name, owning land in the Philippines, dual citizenship, shipping a dearly departed one back to the Philippines, and making court appearances in the Philippines via video. Let's watch.
The officers and staff of the Philippine Consulate in Los Angeles welcomed the Honorable Consul General Edgar Badajos in April of 2021. He is the Philippines' 18th Consul General in Los Angeles, which was opened in 1955 and presently has jurisdiction over Southern California, Southern Nevada, and Arizona. Prior to his arrival in LA, Consul General Badajos served at the Philippine Consulate in Jeddah, Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, from February 2018 to April 2021. A seasoned Filipino diplomat, the Banged Abra native joined the Philippine Foreign Service in January 1997. He has served in various capacities at the Department of Foreign Affairs in Manila. Earlier, he was assigned to the Office of Legal Affairs, Office of Consular Affairs, and the Office of Asian and Pacific Affairs. His previous foreign assignments include the Philippine Consulate in Toronto, Canada, the Philippine Consulate in New York, and the Philippine Embassy in Bangkok, Thailand. For the Consul General, Los Angeles as a foreign service post holds much promise and potential for further improving consular services and collaborating with one of the most dynamic and supportive overseas Filipino communities. He aims to promote and protect the rights and welfare of overseas Filipinos and further enhance Philippine-U.S. relations.
And joining me now is the Consul General of the Philippine Consulate in Los Angeles, the Honorable Edgar Badajos. Welcome to Citizen Pinoy.
Hello, Michael. Good morning.
Thank you for being here. Yeah. I've already given an intro about all the subjects we're going to be covering. First of all, let's find out from you, how many Filipinos are in the Los Angeles area?
Okay, according to the 2019 survey that we have with us, there are about 500,000 in the Los Angeles area.
Okay.
We actually have the biggest Filipino diaspora under the jurisdiction of the Philippine Consulate in Los Angeles.
We're talking outside the Philippines, throughout the world?
Yeah.
L.A. is the biggest?
L.A. is the biggest.
More so than San Francisco or New York?
More so than San Francisco.
Wow.
Although San Francisco covers more states than we do.
Okay.
And also New York. It covers about 10 states.
Okay.
We only cover 3 states, but we have the biggest Filipino diaspora in the U.S. and actually outside the Philippines. We are talking of 1.3 million Filipinos.
What are some of the services or assistance that the Philippine Consulate can offer to Filipinos?
Okay, so basically we process passport applications.
Okay.
That's number one. Then now we do also dual citizenship processing. Mm-hmm. And then number three, we do legalization of documents, or what we call the authentication of legal documents here.
And sort of like notarization with the seal on it.
And, okay. And then we do civil registry processing of reports of birth, report of death.
One of the services that you mentioned was obtaining a Philippine passport. Of course, where else would you get it except for the Philippine consulate?
Correct.
But here's an issue, concern, or fear of many Filipinos in that they come to the U.S. and then they go out of status and their passport expires.
Correct. Mm.
Many of them have said, you know, I'm afraid to go to the Philippine consulate to renew my passport because they may report me to Homeland Security. What do you have to say to those people?
To these people, I tell you, huwag kayong mabahala, because we don't have anything to do with your immigration status here in the U.S. If you come to us for passport renewal, regardless of your immigration status, we will provide service to you.
So you can go to the Philippine consulate and don't have any worries. Now let's talk to about another aspect of passports. A Filipino will enter the U.S. under a Philippine passport with an assumed name.
Identity,
okay,
yeah.
Assumed mm-hmm. identity. Their picture, a different name.
Mm.
They want to now get their passport in their real name.
Mm.
So how can they go about doing that?
Okay, so it will be treated as though the person is applying for an entirely new passport for the first time.
First time passport.
So what we need to do is for the to require the person to provide supporting documents to really establish his correct identity,
mm-hmm.
beginning with an affidavit of explanation.
Okay.
Explaining why, of course, he did that. And then he will have to provide the supporting documents, including a Philippine birth certificate coming from the Philippine Statistics Authority.
Mm-hmm. PSA, yeah.
Other government-issued IDs.
Like a school record or something like that.
Certificate.
In other words, proving whoever the name they're applying
they
under is them.
Yeah.
They're not applying for another assumed name.
Correct,
okay.
Yeah,
go ahead.
So once they're able to do that, then we can submit the application to Manila.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, if they're able to really establish their correct identity, there's no question that they'll be issued a new Philippine passport in their correct identity.
And they're not going to be charged criminally?
Okay. You don't have anything to do with that.
No, but I mean under Philippine law.
No.
You're not going to say, you broke Philippine law, identity theft. They don't have to worry about that.
They don't have to worry about that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that is a tremendous fear of many of the Filipinos out there in terms of applying for a correct Philippine passport under the real name.
Yes.
And a thing you had mentioned is it's as though they're applying for the first time, which means they shouldn't lie or make a bola that, I lost my real passport, correct? They shouldn't say that.
Yeah, no, it'll make their lives more complicated because they say that we lost their passport, then we have to require them to submit also a police report, an affidavit of loss, then we have to submit it to Manila, and there's a waiting period of 15 days, for Manila to verify whether that passport was really lost and then under whose name, et cetera, et cetera. It's very complicated.
The other important thing that you should know about passports is a lot of Filipinos want to travel within the U.S.
Correct,
and what they need is a government-issued photo ID.
Mm.
And in California, they want driver's licenses. If you are out of status, you can't get a driver's license, or now they're coming with a real ID. Important, TSA accepts as one of the accepted documents to board a plane and fly within the U.S. is a Philippine passport,
That's true, yeah. That's correct, yeah.
So be aware of that when I get this, I'm out of status, but I want to travel and I don't have ID, the Philippine passport is there. And I would recommend that people, if they're going to need to renew or certainly apply for a Philippine passport having entered under an assumed name, get it done as soon as possible.
Correct, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, now let's move on to more subjects that Filipinos are asking about. Owning property in the Philippines if you are a dual citizen, Phil-Am, Filipino and U.S. citizen, because a lot of Filipinos think that once they become a U.S. citizen, they're born in the Philippines, they're Filipino, and then they naturalize, that they can no longer own land. Can Phil-Ams own property in the Philippines?
Okay, basic rule about owning property in the Philippines is that you can only buy lands if you are a Filipino citizen.
Okay.
But if you already own that land even before coming here, even if you become an American citizen, you don't lose it just by becoming an American citizen. Now, can the children inherit that property, assuming the Filipino-American dies here in the U.S.?
Okay. And let's say the children are U.S. citizens.
And the children are U.S. citizens.
Okay.
If a child is a U.S. citizen already, that land can be passed on to the children, even if they're U.S. citizens, by way of intestate succession.
Mm-hmm.
There's no will.
Mm-hmm.
There's no will. So in other words, the land passes to the children, even if they're U.S. citizens, automatically by operation of law.
Mm-hmm.
It is different if the Filipino-American executes a will, a last will and testament, wherein he will now state that the property in Lucena City, for example, will go to my son who is in the Philippines. That is not allowed, because that's circumventing the law. To a U.S. citizen child, right?
Okay.
Yeah, because the U.S. citizen child by himself cannot purchase or buy properties in the Philippines because he is a U.S. citizen, mm-hmm. right?
You know, it's kind of weird for me. Just telling you that. Ordinarily, we as attorneys, we tell people, get a will, because if you do not have a will, you can't direct who the property goes to. But you're basically saying they should die intestate without a will so that the kid could get it, but then it could go to a spouse or somebody,
too. For properties.
But what about people who maybe want to retire and get a condo, a non-Filipino?
Well, they can buy condos anytime because we're not talking about lands here. The rule that I said earlier about being a Filipino citizen applies only when you want to buy lands in the Philippines. Okay. But buying condos, it's open to anyone, even foreigners.
Okay,
even
so if I want to retire to the Philippines, I'm American, I was born in the U.S., I could buy a condo over
anytime.
There. Okay.
Yeah, there's no restriction.
So now we move on to, I guess, a similar type of subject, dual citizenship.
Okay.
In the U.S., so you know out there, of course, we're immigration, U.S. immigration show, dual citizenship is recognized, is allowed. So my question is, does the Philippines recognize dual citizenship?
Yes, we do.
Okay.
We do.
So now, moving back to my story, if you have a Filipino who naturalizes but considers himself a dual citizen, now can they buy property?
Yes.
Okay.
Once somebody becomes a dual citizen, that person can now buy properties in the Philippines.
Okay.
Right?
But if they were a Philippine citizen to begin with, then they become a U.S. citizen, they're still a dual citizen, right?
No. We have to distinguish here.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. If somebody comes here as a Filipino citizen and acquires U.S. citizenship, the moment he acquires U.S. citizenship, the only way by which he can retain his Philippine citizenship is to apply for dual citizenship with us.
Okay.
Okay, he cannot automatically retain his being a Filipino citizen. There has to be a positive act, and that consists of having to apply with us for dual citizenship. So if a person gets naturalized as a U.S. citizen today, for example, that person, if he wants to retain his Philippine citizenship, has to go to the Philippine consulate tomorrow.
Okay.
So that he can retain his Philippine citizenship. Yeah.
Are there any requirements other than showing that you were a Philippine citizen?
Two basic requirements.
Okay, sure.
One is the Philippine birth certificate.
Of course.
Issued by the Philippine Statistics Authority, and your naturalization certificate. Those two basic documents.
And then?
Then that's it.
And
very
then
easy.
They're issued a Philippine passport.
Then they apply.
Okay,
no, it's not automatic too.
Okay, yeah.
Once they become a dual citizen, they decide to get a Philippine passport, they have to apply. Which is another complication.
What? Bakit?
The complication comes when the applicant cannot produce a copy of his Philippine birth certificate. And this is very common among Filipinos who were born in the 1930s.
Okay.
Because they don't have record anymore at the Philippine Statistics Office. They get a record wherein it says that there's no record of birth for this person.
Yeah.
And if they cannot produce
Or the Japanese bombed
exactly.
or the termites.
Yeah, and if what they're holding as a Philippine passport is a green passport, meaning the old passport, then we really insist that they submit a Philippine birth certificate.
Okay.
But if they're renewing an e-passport, which is the new passport, then we don't require it anymore.
Okay, because I found that interesting because about not having a birth certificate because to get yourself all the way to U.S. citizenship, they've been showing USCIS a lot of the documents.
Mm.
But you are certainly providing a lot of useful information to our viewers. So let's move to another subject. I get this a lot. A Filipina comes to the U.S. She is married. She then gets divorced in the U.S. The divorce is valid under U.S. law. She meets an American. They get married, which they're entitled to do. The marriage is recognized under U.S. law. Of course, the American would be petitioning her for green card or whatever. She goes to the Philippine consulate, and she wants to get her new Philippine passport issued in the last name of the American
husband.
Right.
So that Filipina cannot get a new passport in the name of the new husband.
Bawal.
Bawal yan. Why?
Bakit?
Because the divorce that she obtained against the poor Filipino husband in the Philippines is not recognized in the Philippines. So under Philippine law, that Filipina remains married to the Filipino husband. The only way by which she can revert to her maiden name is for her to have obtained first an annulment against the Filipino husband. It is different if the Filipina has already acquired U.S. citizenship by other means. If she divorced the husband in the Philippines when she was already an American citizen, then that can be recognized in the Philippines. So we're talking about two different situations here. The first situation is what you mentioned. The Filipina, while still being a Filipino citizen, divorces the poor Filipino husband in the Philippines.
How do you know he's poor? Maybe he was cheating and has a second family.
Just kidding. Okay. So that's the first situation.
Right. Maybe that's the reason she came to the U.S. He was cheating on her, and so she was so depressed and wanted to get rid of him. So okay, maybe, I'm just joking with you, too. Okay, go ahead.
So divorce is not because we don't have divorce in the Philippines.
Right.
That's what I say people who Filipino women who get married. You have to be very sure what surname you will use once you get married, because the moment you adopt the surname of your husband under Philippine law, it'll be very difficult for you to revert to your maiden name.
Okay.
The only way for you to do that is to either annul the marriage, or your spouse dies for whatever reason, or your marriage gets annulled under Article 36 of the Philippine Family Code, which is psychological incapacity. Those are the only ways.
All right, so now that leads me to another topic, which I found fascinating. Has to have court proceedings.
Yes.
And there is now a new benefit procedure or law that Filipinos do not need to appear in person in Philippine court in the Philippines, correct?
That's correct.
So explain that.
Yeah, okay. So I think it's because of the pandemic also.
Okay.
It's very difficult for people who need to appear in court to, of course, go in person. So our Supreme Court made some innovation. They now allow video conferencing. So meaning if a person here in the U.S. needs to appear in court in the Philippines, and there's a court order already directing the person to appear in court, that person can submit a request to us at least a month before the scheduled hearing that he needs to appear in court. He can request that a video conferencing be held at the Philippine consulate.
Okay.
So on the date and time that the hearing is supposed to be held in the Philippines, we're talking in real time here. He can go to the consulate and we can conduct the video conference. The video conference hearings must be scheduled for between 4 to 7 p.m. Monday through Thursday Pacific time.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the Philippine court has to schedule this particular person's appearance during those specific hours.
That's correct.
So they overlap.
Yeah.
Can the person appearing remotely be a party to the action? Or only a witness?
No, it can be a party to the action.
Okay, so let's move to my Filipina who wants an annulment. Can she obtain a Philippine annulment in the Philippines and be able to make the appearances here at the consulate and not have to go back?
I would guess so. What she needs to do is to talk to a Filipino lawyer who can file the annulment case on her behalf. Then later in the course of the proceedings.
And the reason Filipino is it's an attorney licensed to practice Philippine law. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I guess so. That can be done.
So you can get an annulment. That would be a tremendous benefit, because you have people who are Tago na Tago, and of course they cannot go back to the Philippines to make appearances in court.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know what? It's a heck of a lot easier than traveling all the way to the Philippines, especially if you're Tago na Tago. and like I said, whether it's getting that annulment if she wants, or disputes over land case somebody passes away.
And
which leads me to another question about death and bereavement. I don't mean to be a downer with people, but what I see a lot happening is there are the older Filipinos living in the U.S. And they pass away in the U.S. But they still have the connection to the homeland, to the Philippines, no matter how many years they have been in the U.S.,
right, yeah.
No matter whether they're already U.S. citizens, they still consider the Philippines their home.
Right.
And they want to be buried in the Philippines.
In the Philippines,
okay?
Yeah, yeah.
So now the consulate plays a part in that, correct?
Yes, we do.
Okay, so
yeah.
Now if a person passes away, and their wish was to be buried in the Philippines, what must the family do to make that happen?
So the family will have to bring the mortuary certificate to us so that it can be authenticated by the Philippine
consulate. Like a death certificate?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So that it can be authenticated by the Philippine consulate. Without that authentication, the body cannot be shipped. We're talking about the body or the remains or the cremains.
Okay.
Okay. That's the only participation of the Philippine consulate. There's a misconception that the Philippine consulate will have to give its permission. We don't do that. In fact, bulk of the work of processing all the death-related documents will have to be done by the funeral home.
Okay.
The final product of that process is the mortuary certificate, which needs to be brought to us for authentication. Mm-hmm. We can do that in under maybe even 30 minutes or less. Mm-hmm. And then that's done, then the body or the remains can be shipped to the Philippines anytime.
And unless the consulate processes that, it's almost like a customs inspection.
Correct,
because
yeah.
if you don't get that certificate, if you bring the body, the Philippine customs will not allow the body
That's
or the
true.
Remains to enter,
yes.
correct?
Yes, yes. It's a requirement.
Okay, yeah, so bear that in mind as one of your last wishes.
Right.
You know, I have found myself personally, some of the things that you've said today to be eye-opening and extremely informative. What do you consider as Congen to be most rewarding and most challenging about your job?
Okay, the most challenging, let's begin with the most challenging.
Okay.
Most challenging is having to serve 1.3 million Filipinos under our jurisdiction. That's a lot. Mm-hmm. I was in Jeddah before my assignment here. Mm-hmm. And in Jeddah, there were only about 250,000 Filipinos to be served by the Philippines. But here it's 1.3 million Filipinos who would like to have their passports and dual citizenship applications to be processed today or yesterday.
No.
Not today or tomorrow, but yesterday.
Well, I think you have my clients because they all want their green cards yesterday, too.
So, okay, so it's a challenge, you know, and there's so many events here to be attended to. But there are only 36 of us at the Philippine consulate. So you're talking of one consulate personnel serving maybe about 50,000 Filipinos at any given time. Mm-hmm. But the opportunities, there's so much opportunities here because you have so many Filipinos here who can therefore help us in promoting Philippine trade and investment, and who also can help us in promoting Filipino culture, especially during this time when we are seeing a rising incidence of hate crimes against the AAPI community. I believe that those committing hate crimes are those who fail to appreciate the contributions of the Filipino-American to the development of America through the years. And we are just so thankful that we have this big Filipino population under our jurisdiction who can push really the things that we need to push in terms of economic, cultural, and other areas of Philippine interest.
I know the important role that the Philippine consulate plays in Filipinos' lives, whether here in LA, around the U.S., around the world.
Right.
And I commend you for the job that you and everyone else at the consulate is doing. And if I will close with this, like, what message would you like to give your Kababayans here in the U.S.?
I thank them for their contributions, not just to the community here, but to the Filipino nation, because they continue to support the country by way of their contributions in so many ways. Last night I was in another Filipino event, and I was telling them that I'm calling upon the Filipino community to continue helping our country, and I'm sure that they will not fail us. Ang sinasabi ko, you may be able to bring the Filipino out of the Philippines, but the Philippines will always be in the heart of every Filipino. Kaya hindi sira mahirap pakiusapan na ipagpatuloy na tulungan ng ating bayan, especially during this time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
And
yeah.
I also know the remittance that the Filipinos around the world send back home.
10% of our GDP comes from foreign exchange remittances, and bulk of the foreign exchange remittances is coming from the U.S. You're talking of $24 billion annually.
Did you realize that's how much you're sending home to your relatives? Okay. Anyway, I want to thank you on behalf of myself as well as the entire crew of Citizen Pinoy. It has been an honor to have the Honorable Edgar Badajoz here. You have provided us with a wealth of information, not just so simply on immigration. I think, right, diba? Ownership, dual citizenship, things like that. And I do want to thank you so much for helping your kababayans and providing information here on the show. Until next time, ako po si Michael Gerfinkel, and I will see you on Citizen Pinoy.
Kapag na-miss mo, pwedeng balikan. Pwedeng panoorin ang videos at playlists na gusto mo. Like, comment, at ishare ang videos kasama ng lumalaki nating pamilya sa online world. Kahit kailan, kahit saan pa. Forever tayong kapamilya. Kapamilya Online Live.